Hello and welcome to episode 111 of Do More With Your Money. I am your host, TJ Van Gerven. On today's podcast episode, I'm going to speak to you about the dangers of not selling restricted stock immediately when it vests. So if you are compensated in equity via restricted stock and you have your vesting schedule over time, which is typically, you know, a four-year vesting schedule, sometimes you might have a one-year cliff, meaning that after a year you receive 25% of your original grant for your equity compensation. And so, you know, a lot of times people forget about their restricted stock. I mean, just because time goes on, you're focused on your job and you're not necessarily thinking about this other portion of your income. But for, you know, a lot of folks that are compensated in equity, restricted stock can be a substantial portion of their compensation, especially if the share price of the stock has increased over time, right? So you're typically granted, you know, a certain amount of shares, again, that vests over typically a four-year schedule. And the way to think about those vesting shares as you receive them is it's really like receiving a cash bonus in the form of your company stock. The difference is that, you know, it's illiquid to you. So, you know, how much you receive in that quote unquote bonus is tied to the performance of the share price, right? Which is why they like to, companies like to compensate you in equity, because you have a shared interest in the future performance of that company. And so the idea is if you help that company perform well, you know, that should be reflected in the share price of the company. And then you're going to, you know, grow with the performance of the company, right? So it's adding skin in the game. It's adding incentives for you to help the company perform well. However, you know, a lot of times people won't necessarily think about this, you know, compensation, how much it represents of their income, and they won't think about how it, you know, factors into their total investment portfolio, you know, how much of their net worth it is, you know, how concentrated they are in their company's stock. Thinking about future vesting, you know, a lot of times people don't consider how much illiquid skin in the game do I have, meaning how much stock do I still own in this company that I have, I'm going to, you know, go with the performance of this company with, but I don't have access to that equity. So as I'm receiving my vesting shares, should I be selling? Should I be holding on to that? Are there tax benefits to doing so? And I'm going to talk to you about some of the dangers of holding on to your company stock. Because again, I think people get a little confused around this because there are different tax treatments for different types of equity. Again, today we're just speaking about restricted stock units. If you receive stock options, those are going to be taxed differently and are a little bit more complicated. But with restricted stock, it's literally just them giving you stock over time. And then basically once it vests, you are taxed on the market value of that stock on that date that it vests. So the way to reframe that is if you were to receive a cash bonus, would you take that bonus and then buy your company stock? Because that's essentially what you're doing if you have vested stock and then you hold on to it. It's just basically making a unconscious decision to say, hey, I want to have more exposure to this company, or I want to keep my exposure to this company, because you actually had exposure to the company because it was unvested, meaning it was not in your control, but it's, you know, it's for you in the future, assuming again that you stay with the company over that vesting period. So then the question becomes, okay, when it does vest, should I be selling? And there's a couple of reasons to consider why you should be selling. And this is some of the dangers that I want to speak to you about today. A lot of times, people's withholding on vesting equity via restricted stock is not as high as their actual tax rate. So for example, you might have 22% federal taxes withheld on your vesting stock, but you might be in the 35% federal tax bracket. And this happens a lot with couples I see, because your company, your employer doesn't know your overall tax situation. They just know, they're just going based off of your compensation. So, you know, if your spouse is also a high earner and your guys' combined income puts you in a higher marginal tax bracket, there might be a, you know, in this case, 13% difference there, where there's not enough being withheld. And so the issue that creates is that if you're not aware of that, then come tax time, you might get hit with this tax bill and say, oh, why am I owing thousands of dollars? And it's because the withholding on your vesting stock is not as high as your actual, you know, marginal tax bracket for federal taxes, especially, and then depending on your state as well, they might not be withholding enough there as well. So that's the first danger, is that, okay, I'm not having enough withheld. And then what can happen is, let's say you have that stock vest and the market is performing well when it vests, you're going to be taxed again at that valuation at that time. Let's say the company or market environment turns around, and then over the next 6 months, the share price gets cut in half. Maybe you work for, you know, a very speculative or growth-oriented company, an early tech company, something like that. And it's very common for, you know, a share price to decrease, you know, 30, 40, 50%, even if it performs well over the long term. And so you can get in a situation where, okay, I'm taxed at this high kind of watermark value, and I owe taxes based on that value, but now that my share price has dropped, and so come tax time, you know, if you haven't planned ahead for that, you might be forced to liquidate your shares at 50% of what you were taxed at. Now, you're going to get a loss, but that's a capital loss. It's not the same as, you know, that can only be used against future capital gains. It's not the same as income taxes, so it can't offset your income. It can only offset future capital gains. And so it can be a really kind of dangerous situation that I've seen where, again, you're basically owing taxes on money that you don't have anymore. Now, if you are to hold on to the shares and the shares appreciate, that's great. It still doesn't provide any tax savings because you are taxed as income when those shares vest. So if you hold on to those shares and then they increase in value and then you sell, yes, if they increase very quickly, you know, right after you receive them, then there could be benefits to waiting for 1 year to sell so that you're meeting the long-term capital gain tax rate. But again, you're still being taxed as income when they vest. So there's no actual tax benefit. It's just like purchasing a stock where you're going to be taxed at short-term capital gain rates if you sell before a year, and then long-term capital gain rates if you hold beyond a year. But we should never make financial planning or investment decisions solely based on taxes. Taxes is an important thing to understand and consider, but at the end of the day, what really matters is, are you allocated appropriately, you know, based on what you're trying to achieve? So again, the major danger to be considered of when receiving vesting stock is, you know, is my withholding matching up to my actual income tax rate? You know, am I going to be caught off guard by a tax bill, you know, come next April? And then, am I comfortable with my exposure in my company stock, right? What percentage of my investment assets does this represent? I would consider anything more than 5% within an individual stock relative to your investment assets to be considered concentrated. I would consider anything above 10% of your investment assets to be highly concentrated. It is somewhat subjective as far as concentration risk, but, you know, owning a large percentage of your net worth in a single stock, while it can provide tremendous upside, it can also provide tremendous downside. And so if you are comfortable with your longer term investing strategy, most of the time it makes sense to sell immediately and then transition to your long-term strategy that you have conviction in and that is sustainable for you. So again, that is highly dependent on the idea that you are comfortable with your long-term investing strategy. Regardless of how you feel about it, you should still be making conscious decisions, right? What percentage of my investment assets do I currently own in my company's stock? And then on top of that, let's factor in the unvested equity that I still have. And this is something that people definitely miss is, okay, yes, I'm looking at my current concentration risk, but let's now factor in, assuming I'm going to stay with my company over the net, you know, over the life of that vesting schedule, will now have even more concentration risk, and it's actually illiquid, which even argues more to diversify. And so this is kind of the second danger of restricted stock, is not considering unvested equity, because again, assuming you're going to stay with your company, you still have skin in the game there. And so you really are at the mercy of that share price and what's going to happen there, which is a good thing. I mean, if you're working for a company, I assume that you have conviction in that company and you're going to add, you want to add value to that company. So that's a good thing overall. But again, once that vests and kind of comes due, that's your reward because you've been investing in that company for the time that you've been there. So to conclude, those are the two major downside risks I see with restricted stock. Number one is not understanding your withholding versus your actual tax rate, having the potential situation where the share price drops and you owe taxes on that high watermark value. And then the second would be not understanding your concentration risk, both for what's currently vested and what is still unvested. So that concludes today's episode. I hope you have a great rest of your week.